Hi, I'm Abby West, your Audible editor, and I'm here today with author Wayétu Moore to talk about her amazing debut novel, She Would Be King. It's beautiful.
Thank you.
And not only is she the author of this book, she is the narrator. And why did you decide to narrate your own book?
So I have a background in theater. Writing has always been present in my life, but when I started undergrad, it was for theater. And so I knew that I wanted to engage with the narrative in another form than just like writing, and of course like reading it back through the editing process. And so when the opportunity came up and they said that the audiobook rights had sold, I asked if I could submit my voice and made a little recording and submitted it. So I was happy that it was chosen. And of course I wanted them to choose whoever was the best for the job, but I was happy that they chose me.
So you had to audition for your own book.
Yes, I had to audition for it, but that's good because I, like I said, I wanted the best person to play the role. So,
and that's, I mean, it came through because not only are you embodying the work, but you're really driving home the accents, and which are a really important part of the of narrative. Explain why that was important.
Yeah, for sure. I think in general, when you hear or see African characters, either in film or in audiobooks, there tends to be like this generic African accent. Liberian accents are very specific because they are in a lot of ways an amalgamation of indigenous dialects, African-American dialects, and then also Caribbean dialects as well. And so I wanted to make sure that it was done well, because it was sort of an introduction. I think it's going to be an introduction for many to Liberian culture and Liberian accents. Even though, obviously, when I go to Liberia, they tell me my accent is awful. So for a Western audience, I think I hope it's okay.
Now, this reason is important to backtrack to what She Would Be King is about. It is a beautiful, magical realism take on the beginnings of Liberia. Mm-hmm. Looking through three really powerful characters and how they sort of came together to help the tension between the indigenous population and the settlers, essentially, mm-hmm. coming from America. You're a Liberian.
I am.
Where did this story come from for you? And how is it connected personally for you?
So my family moved to America when I was 5 years old, and I spent my formative years in Texas. I was in the suburbs of Texas. There were very few black families and no African families other than my own. And so being a minority in that way and really not encountering or interacting with Liberian culture outside of my home, that absence was very profound. And so when I became an artist and realized that I wanted to pursue writing as a career, Liberia was just the first place I went to. I wanted to explore that history because it is so vast. My mother's family is indigenous. She's Bai. They have been in Liberia for hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of years. My father's family, they moved to Liberia in the 1870s from South Carolina after being terrorized by the KKK. So I'm of mixed descent. Many Liberians are of mixed indigenous and American, either the United States or Caribbean descent. And so wanting to tell the vastness of that story and the complexity of the identities is something that I just always wanted to do. And magical realism is a genre that has always interested me. It was really my introduction to storytelling. When my mother or my grandmother would tell me stories growing up, it was just rare that someone wasn't flying or disappearing. And so when I began to write, I knew that magical realism was my negotiation of the architecture of story. That's how I understood stories worked. So it was sort of like the perfect marriage, Liberian history, and then magical realism or Afrofuturism just came about.
Now, you mentioned that you did a read-through of your own work when you were writing and in the editing process. But did you learn anything different about your work, or did it impact you differently when you were narrating it?
Reading all the way through is just a wonderful exercise that I think I'm going to practice in my subsequent books, because it pulls your work into another dimension. It was a wonderful process, and I'm definitely going to do that with other books.
Yeah. Speaking of other books, you've done your memoir.
Yeah.
Is it completed now?
Just about. Going through edits now. So that's also going to be coming out with Grey Wolf. In the next 12 months, we're not sure when, but it deals with my family's immigration, but it also engages with magical realism, because when the Liberian War happens, the way that my father explained it to us was that we were running from dragons. And so it's an exploration of that story, like from a child, how does a child reconcile and how does a child negotiate the reality of a war? And so I was able to use my love and affinity for fantasy in that book as well. So I'm excited about it.
When we're talking about own voices and getting to own your own narrative, essentially, I feel like that's a big part of the foundation that you started, One More Book. Mm-hmm. Can you tell the folks who are not familiar with it what your nonprofit is?
Yeah, so One More Book is a nonprofit that creates literature for children who rarely see themselves in literature. And so the goal is to look at the most vulnerable populations and commission writers and illustrators from those countries and create books that those children can relate to. So we have 23 books for Liberia, Guinea, Haiti. We have an Afro-Brazilian book, and we are working on a book for Ghana now, as well as translations into indigenous languages of our Liberia titles, and a sequel to a very successful anti-corruption children's book called Bagba by a writer named Robtel Paley. And so it gives me just great joy to work with these artists, mainly writers who are also passionate. A lot of them are novelists and fiction writers who sort of know how alienating it can be as a writer of color in an agency that has expectation biases and just different things that you have to deal with just to get your work out there.
Yeah.
And being able to be self-empowered and create those stories that in an authentic way for children who could benefit from them the most is very fulfilling.
What other kinds of stories do you have in you?
What other kinds of stories? Well, right now I'm working on a novel that explores the myth of Mami Wata. So every country has, or I would say every corner of the world has its iteration of a mermaid. And in Liberia or parts of West Africa, her name is Mami Wata. But Mami Wata is actually a bit of a tragic story because she pulls people down in the water so she won't be alone. Mm-hmm. And so it's about this girl who is bullied. She lives in Texas and she's bullied for being different. And a bully pushes her in the water and she realizes that she can breathe underwater. So then what happens when someone who is vulnerable and traumatized in a lot of ways by her peers is given that sort of power? What does she do with it? And so I think in my work, I try to negotiate the idea of power. Like, what is power? What does power mean? What does power mean for vulnerable or oppressed groups?
That comes through a lot in She Would Be King. Mm-hmm. I'm thinking of, particularly with June Day's family.
Yes.
Mother who, when she realized that she couldn't be seen.
Yes.
And praying that her child would not be seen as well, so mm-hmm. it could, you know, not have to endure the slavery.
Mm-hmm.
That sense of, like, overwhelming power and learning how to deal with that, that's sort of a thread through.
Yeah. I wanted to make the three main characters in She Would Be King, I wanted their powers to coincide with the culture that they were representing. And these, of course, are the cultures that comprise the Liberian identity. And to reiterate, it's indigenous, Liberian, and then African American, and then also Caribbean American. And so with June Day, his resilience in many ways is an homage to African American resilience and the fact that as African Americans, being a group, having gone through so much over time and not having faltered yet and still going strong. And I wanted to make sure that his gift was in conversation with the women who were in mm-hmm. his life.
It's a very strong, I mean, as if the title doesn't give that sense, very strong feminist mm-hmm. narrative throughout it. And how does that fit into the zeitgeist right now? Like, it's another mm-hmm. one of these books that just feels right for the time. Mm-hmm. Did you have that sense? You actually started it in 2009, I believe.
Yeah, I did. So the first draft of the book was written in 2009 as my master's thesis, and I put it away for a few years and didn't pick it up until 2013. So I edited it on and off for a couple of years, and it sold in 2015, and it's just now coming out. So just to give you an idea of that process, how long it is and the amount of patience it entails. I feel like it is timely, but it also just I think is a testament to the fact that the need for feminism or the breath of feminism is always timely. And then in terms of, I guess, magical realism or Afrofuturism, that being timely, in 2015, we actually received a lot of no's because people were saying, that's more in YA, the fantasy genre, mm-hmm. literary fiction, black superheroes, we're not too sure.
Right.
And then 2018, enter Black Panther. And so now, like, every other book that's being sold is African fantasy. Yeah. So I'm excited about where the genre is going to go and that there seems to be room and interest.
Wayétu, I can't thank you enough for joining us today here at Audible. And we're looking forward to more work from you. And you can find She Would Be King on audible.com.